Hello everybody, welcome back to St. Philomena's PU College official channel. This is Arokya Das and I'm teaching you Kingdom Animalia Chapter 4 Session 6. Already I have completed 5 sessions and in every session I'm reminding you to go through the starting 4 or 5 classes as many number of times. Why? Because most of the terms used in biology are Greek and Latin. If you attend any of the class in between, suppose you are missing the introductory classes, the entire subject will be like Greek and Latin for you. Then you may start telling your parents that biology is difficult. Believe me, biology is very, very easy unless and until you go through my past sessions, that is session 1 to 5, many number of times and by doing your homework. I'll remind you what I explained in my past class. In my past class, I started to explain phylum Porifera, its general characters or salient features, and the point one by one. I explained you. The students have already attended, you'll be familiar with what I'm saying now. If you're not yet attended, please attend those class and then you can come. Hence, this is an offline class, pre-recorded class. This is the major advantage for you. You can watch cool and calmly whenever you want and as many number of times you desire. Phylum Porifera, general characters and examples I explained, and I also introduced you to some new terminologies, basic terminologies. And as you know, you have studied already these general characters in your school days also, but one or two or three to four extra points we are studying in detail. After studying phylum Porifera and its example, we shifted towards the next phylum, Coelenterata and then Cnidaria. Sorry, Coelenterata, Cnidaria, both are same terminologies. And the next phylum is Ctenophora. I can call this Coelenterata and Ctenophora as twin phylums. This I am calling, not any other taxonomist or biologist calling. Because why am I telling? I am calling because almost the general characters of Coelenterata and Ctenophora are almost same. If you have studied, you will also agree with what I am saying. Coelenterata and Ctenophora, they resemble one another and most of the general characters are similar, but there are some unique characters which both of these phylum do not share between them. We studied the general characters, we also studied few examples and key terms I underlined and asked you to make a note. In today's class, we will go to the fourth phylum called phylum Platyhelminthes. Let me share the screen for you. So, in this session 6, we are going to study the fourth phylum of non-chordata in animal kingdom in detail. So, what is this phylum Platyhelminthes? Phylum Platyhelminthes word is derived from Greek. As I said, most of the terms in biology, both in botany and zoology, the terms have been derived from Greek and Latin. Now, Platyhelminthes is derived from a Greek word. You have to know the meaning in English also. Then only this particular topic will be easy for you. The word Platyhelminthes, you can split it as, I'm splitting the word Platyhelminthes. Platy in Greek refers to flat. Make a note of it. Helminthes means worms. Worms, flat and worms. So in English, we usually call them, commonly call them as flat worms. Hope you have come across the term flat worms in your school days already. And if I ask you to give example, you'll give at least one or two examples, right? We'll get into the general characters or salient features of phylum Platyhelminthes and we'll study one by one. See, as the name indicates, we have to know why this name has been given to this phylum. First point says, the body is डॉर्सो वेंट्रली फ्लैटेंड, इट इज फ्लैटेंड डॉर्सो वेंट्रली, डॉर्सो वेंट्रली फ्लैटेंड अंत ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ, इफ इफ यू टेक माय पाम, आई थिंक यू कैन सी दिस, सी ऑन द राइट कॉर्नर ऑफ योर स्क्रीन, इफ यू टेक दिस पाम, दिस इज फ्लैटेंड ऑन दिस सर्फेस, दिस इज द डॉर्सल सर्फेस एंड दिस इज द वेंट्रल सर्फेस, ಮೇಲ್ಗಡೆ ಮತ್ತೆ ಕೆಳಗಡೆ. ಸೊ ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಫ್ಲಾಟನ್ಡ್, ದಿ ಆರ್ಗಾನಿಸಮ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ದಿಸ್ ಫೈಲಮ್ ಆರ್ ಫ್ಲಾಟನ್ಡ್ ಡಾರ್ಸೋ ವೆಂಟ್ರಲಿ, ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಫ್ಲಾಟ್ ನಾಟ್ ಲ್ಯಾಟ್ರಲಿ. ದಿಸ್ ಪೊಸಿಷನ್ ಇಸ್ ಲ್ಯಾಟ್ರಲಿ ಫ್ಲಾಟನ್ಡ್, ಈ ಸೈಡ್ ಮತ್ತೆ ಈ ಸೈಡ್, ಓಕೆ, ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಲ್ಯಾಟ್ರಲಿ ಫ್ಲಾಟನ್. ಬಟ್ ವಾಟ್ ಐ ಆಮ್ ಟೆಲಿಂಗ್ ಇಸ್ ದ ಆರ್ಗಾನಿಸಮ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ಡಾರ್ಸೋ ವೆಂಟ್ರಲಿ ಫ್ಲಾಟನ್ಡ್. ಯು ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಸಿ ಅ ಸ್ಕೇಲ್ ಆಫ್ ಯು, ಯುವರ್ ಸ್ಕೇಲ್ ಪೆನ್ಸಿಲ್ ರೂಲರ್, ದಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಫ್ಲಾಟನ್ಡ್, ಓಕೆ, ಲೈಕ್ ದಟ್. So they are dorsoventrally flattened organisms. Their body is flat. That's why this phylum derives the name, because the organisms of this phylum are dorsiventrally flattened. Hence, in English, we call it as flatworms. In Greek, they call it as platyhelminthes. Hope this point is clear for you. Moving on to the second point. They are bilaterally symmetrical. The students who are following my class regularly in order, it may be flashing for you now. We have studied bilaterally symmetrical in the introductory class, but while studying the phylum for the first time we are coming across bilateral symmetry in the phylum. Because when we saw phylum Porifera, the first phylum, I mentioned it is asymmetry. The body is having no proper shape. Then we came to phylum Coelenterata, radial symmetry, and then another phylum Ctenophora, it also exhibited radial symmetry. Now in this fourth phylum, that is phylum Platyhelminthes, bilateral symmetry is emerging for the first time. This word is emerging for the first time. So it is clear that bilateral symmetry is the advanced type of body symmetry in the organisms or animals. The primitive one is radial symmetry. So from now onwards, the future phylums, what we are going to study further, should be having bilateral symmetry in their body. So this is how you should learn biology, not just mugging up. Okay, sumne mug up madodalla, iva artha madkobeku. So we are coming across bilateral symmetry. So in the introductory class I said there are only three types of symmetry. One is asymmetry, primitive one. The next one is radial symmetry, and the third advanced one is bilateral symmetry. So we came across bilateral symmetry in Platyhelminthes. So this is Platyhelminthes is the first phylum to possess bilateral symmetry on its body. What is this bilateral symmetry? I said do not explain while writing the general characters. I said you to just mention Platyhelminthes or flatworms are bilateral symmetry. But if a question is asked you, what is bilateral symmetry, given example, then you have to tell bilaterally symmetrical animals are those whose body is cut only through central median axis. We get two equal halves, wherein one half is the mirror image of another half. Better stick on to the definition, what is there in the study material, and write that one. You are not supposed to write your own definition, own sentences, when it is asked for a one mark question. Understood? You may be writing a right, correct meaning, but if the sentence and some keywords are missing, means the definition will fetch you 0 marks. Now, first point, the body is dorsoventrally flattened, hence they are called as flatworms. The second point, they are bilaterally symmetrical animals. Enough. No need of writing any extra points. Now the third point, they are triploblastic in condition. Once again, I'm reminding you, bilateral symmetrical is a term we came across for the first time. And now again, triploblastic. Poriferans, we did not discuss about diploblastic or triploblastic because they had cellular level of body organization, right? And then we came to Coelenterata and Ctenophora, both had tissue level of body organization and both were diploblastic in nature. What is diploblastic meaning? Diploblast means the organism's body is made up of two germ layers, outer ectoderm and inner endoderm, right? Now here, for the first time in this phylum or in animal kingdom, we are coming across another term, triploblastic. Tri means how much? It is three germ layers, three germ layers. What are the three germ layers? Outer ectoderm, inner endoderm and middle mesoderm, right? Outer ectoderm, inner endoderm and middle mesoderm. Once again I repeat, need not explain the definition here. You can just mention flatworms or platyhelminthes are triploblastic in nature. Enough. That point is enough, because this is not a direct question for you to explain the point. Organ level of body organization. Once again I brief you, poriferans had what? Cellular level of body organization. Second phylum, coelenterates had tissue level of body organization. Third phylum, ctenophorans had also tissue level of body organization. Now platyhelminthes are having organ level of body organization. Once again, this point also in animal kingdom, platyhelminthes are the first phylum to have bilateral symmetry, triploblastic body condition and organ level of body organization, right? Here in this fourth point you can come to a conclusion that in platyhelminthes we can see some, not all the organs, but some organs are formed. So this phylum platyhelminthes gives the initiation, okay, for the formation of few organs, not the entire organ system. Sulpa organs matra form agutte, okay na? So we will move to the next point. Flatworms may be free living or parasitic. While speaking about coelenterata, like colony and free living form, I showed you a diagram, right? Poriferans were non-motile, they were attached. Poriferans animals alla bandu fix agitto avugalige move madak aagta irlilla. Ade tara coelenterata dalli nodidaga few organisms were attached and few organisms were free swimming or free living. Now here also the same terminology, some of the platyhelminthes or some flatworms are free living, okay, they can move around, and some are parasitic. I will show you the parasite diagram at the end of these points. I will show you the photograph also. So swalpa flatworms move around agbodu, matte swalpa parasites banbuto fix agi irtave host olgade, okay? So parasite, I believe everybody will be knowing, parasite is the organism which depend on another organism. We call them as host. Parasites are the organisms which depend on other organisms for food and shelter. So now one more important thing I have highlighted in blue color, green color also I have highlighted. This is once again an important question for you. Hooks and suckers. Hooks and suckers are present in parasitic form. Hook fix agadike adar baayalli mullu tara irthade, exactly not the word mullu, ad baayalli anchorage agakke aa hallugalu tara on structure irthade, hook anta kadivi, adu bandi fix agutte, fix agutte adrulagade digestive system alli ellara fix agi alle anchor agirodikke hooks na use maartade. Hooks are somewhat like teeth like structure, they are not exactly the teeth. Okay, they come and fix into the host body so that they can get proper anchorage inside the host. And suckers, as the name indicates, sucker means to draw the nourishment, food na absorb madodike ee sucker galna use martade. The suckers will be used to suck out or absorb or draw the nutrition from the host body. So hooks and sucker you don't find in all the animals. For example, ant. Ant doesn't belong to this phylum, but still, if you take an ant, we cannot call it as a parasite, because ant will be having a different type of mouth parts. Ant will not be having hook, ant will not be having a sucker, right? They will be having a different type of mouth part. And you can take, for example, mosquito. Mosquito also does not belong to phylum platyhelminthes, but mosquito everybody have encountered in your life, right? So it will be having a sharp mouth like a sharp thorn like structure. I can use, it's not a thorn, it's a mouth part. So that will be used to pierce into the body and draw or suck out the blood like a syringe. So hooks and suckers are not found in all the organisms. Hooks and suckers, it is a specific character or a unique character only of parasites, not any other organisms. All organisms have hooks and suckers. Okay, so these may be free living or parasitic. Parasites agidre avugalli hook mate sucker irutade. Okay na, make it as a point, whenever we study about, whenever we mention this term, what is this term which I have circled down? Whenever we mention triploblastic condition, immediate point that should strike in your brain is to mention about coelom condition. Innond sala helthin kelaskolli, yavaga neevu triploblastic condition anta mention martiro, from this phylum onwards in future all the phylum will be triploblastic. Okay, don't forget, because triploblastic is the advanced condition. Once you mention about triploblastic condition, your next thought or next comment on the on that particular phylum is, it should be the condition of coelom in the body. Understood? So here you can write this sixth point. You can also write after three note, not a problem. As I said, I have stuck on to the points that are given in textbook. So after telling there are triploblastic, you can just mention immediately after that acoelomates. That is actually a good idea of studying the general characters. Once you tell they are triploblastic, immediately you mention about what type of coelom they will be having. Okay, that is the type of memorizing the general characters in animals. Acoelomates, my second session, if you remember, okay, those are not attended, my first, second, third and fourth session, once again I am reminding you, do attend that class and come, because now you will not understand what I am telling this term. Acoelomates, as I said, what is a coelom? I mentioned coelom means internal body cavity. Coelom is a Greek word and in English we call it as internal body cavity. And I also mentioned here acoelomates, A refers to what? Absent. A refers to absent. And what does this coelom refers to? Coelom refers to internal body cavity. Coelom refers to internal body cavity. A refers to absent here. So in this organisms, coelom is absent. Andre, ee organisms galalli internal body cavity absent. Aste. These organisms do not possess coelom. Any sentence you can write. But make it as a sentence. Don't simply mention as like acoelomate. Everybody has studied and I believe everybody knows to frame a sentence at least. You can write they are acoelomates. At least they are you can add. Okay, or else you can also write flatworms are acoelomates. Something like that you should write. Don't mention just a word as I have mentioned on the slide. Got? Next point. A very unique point and a very important point. This term you will not come across in other phylum. Flatworms possess specialized cells. And these specialized cells are called as flame cells, which helps in, again important, which helps in, means the function of flame cells is osmoregulation and excretion. Cells are performing this function, not an organ. If I ask you what is the function of kidney in humans, kidney also performs the same function what is mentioned in blue color, that is osmoregulation and excretion. Hence these are primitive organisms. Organs are formed but particular organs only are formed, not all the organs. So what happens, there are some cells which are specialized. That much if you remember, that is more than enough. They are specialized only to perform what function? Osmoregulation and excretion. Why? You should ask yourself in your mind, because they are primitive organisms, there is no excretory system, that's why. Understood. Now I just want to I just want you to have a look of how this exactly looks like, specialized cell. This black and white picture, what is there on your screen, is called as it's called as flame cell. Below there is a word called as fasciola hepatica. Okay, don't worry, the scientific names and all now you need not study. I just took this diagram from internet. This is, in English we call it as liver fluke. Okay, now this structure what is there in front of you is called as a specialized cell called as flame cells. Not okay though. See, this is a single cell, it looks like somewhat flame like maybe, that's why. And inside this there is a bunch of cilia. Bunch of cilia means it is nothing like, it is hair like structures. This bunch of minute microscopic hair like structure, they will be moving like a whip of a candle mele binki urita irutade gotta aa tara, the flame which is on the candle, it will be burning, right? It looks like that when it is fully functional, it will be just moving like that. That's why it has got the name flame cell. That is a single cell. This is a single cell. Okay, this is a single cell. You can find a nucleus here. These are the cytoplasm, and the plasma membrane is folded into many foldings. Ivaga see here, this is the normal cell. Okay, the same cell, this is the plasma membrane. The same cell, I'll write like this. Now this is the nucleus, the plasma membrane, like amoeba. They are also using the word pseudopodia. You can see here, pseudopodia, right? The plasma membrane is folded into many irregular folds, pseudopodia, right? So that's why it is called as flame cells, and its function is osmoregulation and excretion. You need not draw this diagram or learn this diagram. You should only know there are some specialized cells called as flame cells, and the function is osmoregulation and excretion. Done. This is just for explanation. I use this diagram. Without diagram, you will also not get an idea how it looks, how, why it is called as flame cell. That's why. Yates 1 is a familiar point for you. We have been studying this point since phylum 1. Today we are in phylum 5. Sexes are not separate. I gave you one terminology, once again a Greek word, and I asked you to put it in your mind and learn the spelling and pronounce properly. Now also I tell, I'll write it. If you cannot pronounce or if you cannot remember the spelling properly, you write it as a dictation. Write for 10-15 times without seeing, you will come to know the pronunciation and the spelling properly. If sexes are not separate, or else vice versa, I will tell, in a single organism you find male and female sex organ, that type of organism we call them as hermaphrodite. ಇದರಲ್ಲಿ ಮೇಲ್ ಸಪರೇಟ್ ಇರಲ್ಲ, ಫೀಮೇಲ್ ಸಪರೇಟ್ ಇರೋದಿಲ್ಲ. ಒಂದೇ ಅನಿಮಲ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಮೇಲು ಮತ್ತೆ ಫೀಮೇಲ್ ಸೆಕ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ಗನ್ ಇರುತ್ತೆ. ಅಂತ ಅನಿಮಲ್ ನ ನಾವು ಹರ್ಮಾಫ್ರೋಡೈಟ್ಸ್ ಅಂತ ಕರಿತೀವಿ. ಈ ಅನಿಮಲ್ಸ್ ಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಮೇಲ್ ಸೆಕ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ಗನ್ ಮೆಚೂರ್ ಆಗಿದ್ರೆ ಫೀಮೇಲ್ದು ಮೆಚೂರ್ ಆಗಿರೋದಿಲ್ಲ. ಅದ್ರದ್ದು ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಸೀಸನ್ ಫೀಮೇಲ್ ಸೆಕ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ಗನ್ ಮೆಚೂರ್ ಆದ್ರೆ ಮೇಲ್ದ ಸೆಕ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ಗನ್ ಮೆಚೂರ್ ಆಗಿರೋದಿಲ್ಲ. ಅರ್ಥ ಆಯ್ತಿದ್ಯಾ? ಸೊ ದಿಸ್ ಕಂಡೀಷನ್ ವೇರ್ ಬೋತ್ ಮೇಲ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಫೀಮೇಲ್ ಸೆಕ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ಗನ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ಫೌಂಡ್ ಇನ್ ಅ ಸಿಂಗಲ್ ಇಂಡಿವಿಜುವಲ್ ವಿ ಕಾಲ್ ಇಟ್ ಆಸ್ hermaphrodite. But here you can just mention, while telling the general characters in exam, you can just tell sexes are not separate, no problem. But you should be knowing the meaning. Without knowing the meaning, you may have to mug up, that's it. Ninth point, fertilization is internal. Section 3, phylum Porifera, I mentioned you. Fertilization alli erdu tara ide. There are two types of fertilization. Primitive one, external fertilization, and advanced one is internal fertilization. External fertilization means what? They will be living in water, sperms will be in water, and egg also will be shed in water. Fertilization occurs outside the body in the water medium, we call it as external fertilization. And if the fertilization, fusion of sperm and egg occurs in the body, then inside the body, then we call it as internal fertilization. Hope you are clear with it. And the latter half of the same point, the development is indirect. Development is indirect. Same, Section 3, Phylum Porifera, I explained you for 10 minutes. More than 10 minutes, I explained you. In animal kingdom, there are two types of development. The primitive one is indirect development. Hope you believe that, hope you remember the diagram of frog what I showed. Metamorphosis of frog from egg to adult stage involving many larval stages, right? And direct development, I gave you the example of a dog, and also I said you to keep in mind about humans. Direct development means the young ones are similar to the parents, but size will be small and they won't be sexually matured. Indirect development means what? From egg to adult stage, there will be numerous larval stages involved. Direct, indirect development ante helidre egg inda adult agatanka larval stages irutte anta mention madi saaku. Okay, the development which includes numerous or larval stages from egg to adult stage is called as indirect development. And direct development means what? The young ones will be miniature of adults, but they will be small in size and they won't be sexually matured. That's why I am telling you, if it is still difficult to understand, go to session 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 again, and you will get a clear cut idea what is this internal fertilization and direct and indirect development. One of the unique point, okay, one of the unique point here now. Planaria. Planaria you might have seen in your school days. It's quite a famous animal maybe for you. Has the power of regeneration. Regeneration. This is a unique point and important from the examination point of what? Point of view. Now what is this regeneration refers to? I'll try to draw planaria. See, I'm using this digital board for the first time, but still I believe I'm using it for the best, right? So maybe some diagrams are not good as yours, but still try to adjust until I to get pakka with this one. This is planaria. If this animal is cut off like this by chance, idu eradu piece aga hoyitu ant helidre, this half will develop into one individual and this half will develop into another individual. So it will become two individuals. This power of producing themselves, complete individual, is called as regeneration. This point they have strongly mentioned in the general characters of Platyhelminthes in your textbook. So these are the general characters. Okay, these are the general characters. This also explained, this is the structure of flame cell and the function. I just collected some examples, original pictures. The first one is liver fluke. It is a endoparasite. It is a parasite. This is a liver fluke. The second one is a flat ribbon-like structure you can see in the intestine. This organism is, in English we call it as, I'm giving you the common names, okay? That is enough. No need of learning the scientific name unless and until I tell you. This is tapeworm. And the third one is, just now I did the diagram. General characters you should know, and you should mention one or two examples. Examples, learn the common English name only. In your study material, As I said, I have stuck on to the textbook. So their scientific name also will be there and common name also will be there. I suggest you to read only common name. Understood? Don't mug up and learn the spelling and make your biology difficult. Just try to learn common name to give example. To mention, there are 10 points in platyhelminthes. 10 general characters or salient features you have to learn. I have highlighted these important terms in each point. All these points with these keywords you can write in your own sentence. Write in your own sentence, because we are not going to give definition for any one of this. Right? You can pause this screen, take your notes, and then you can write down, because the same thing I have given in the study material also. Better read at least 2 or 3 points without seeing the screen or the screenshot. Try to write it in your notes. I will be checking your notes when you come to college. Right? So make and write the notes neatly. Not for my sake, for your sake, because most of the students are losing the ability to write. One or the other ability students are losing during this pandemic. You don't be one among them. Write the points neatly in your biology book. You can use scale, pencil and all. Make it neat. Only this much is enough. These points are enough. Read as many number of times you can. So from today's class, I am signing out. Take care.